Oh yeah. Oh. Yeah, I made a promise to. Sorry, it sounded like I was talking to anyone but myself. I wanted to look up and see whether or not this was a auspicious thing. Yeah, there is. Yeah, as a matter of fact, I got the word that it was going to be ready to launch at exactly 1:30. I was like, well, we're going to be doing weird things. And Corey's like, well, you want me to man the helm? I was like, you have the con. She's all yours.
Yeah.
But it's a good episode. But you can watch it. It's a good episode, but you can watch it after this, all right?
As long as you watch it twice.
Yeah.
Watch it twice after this. It's the only way it works mathematically.
By the way,
it's got to be good.
My research is done. I will be sharing my findings on the show.
Ominous findings, Andrew.
My research says you're guilty. Of what? Does it matter? You'll be in jail either way.
How's LA, Andrew?
LA is nice.
Good times.
Yes. The awesome. Weather is cold here.
Did it get cold?
Well, LA cold.
LA cold. So like what, 52?
I mean, like, I'll bring my pullover, but I won't actually wear it, but I'll have it.
It turns out he's describing Austin weather right now. Is LA cold?
No, because that does Austin has humidity. So like there is an element of like normal weather where LA is like when it gets cold, it's a chill, but like it doesn't normally because the sun's pretty hot.
Yeah, I mean, this is like perfect summer weather in like other parts of like the world right now.
Yeah.
But it's nice. It's really nice. I go out and walk, been walking every day. So
yeah.
We were just talking about a car.
Don't judge me. I do have a car. I can afford a car, everybody.
It's like I take my Tesla for a walk. It's like it's leashed and driving itself.
I mean, it could have it follow you.
That'd be awesome to have stalker mode.
I could like put some snacks and some soft drinks in it. You know, just go for a walk and stop. Yeah, I told you when I saw one of those at the street fair. I saw one of those, and first, like, oh, and like elderly people, and I'm like, how do they get in and out of the car? Oh, well, you know, bro. Okay, and then, and I'm like, oh, is it using is it like tracking the person using like a Bluetooth thing on your phone? I'm like, oh no, it just uses it's visual. It's all visual. She goes, let me show you, and she stands because she starts walking, and some dude walks between her and the robot turns and starts to follow the dude. And I'm
just,
like,
just like an actual golden retriever.
I'm like, yep, and I know what software you used. So.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, I was like, it's
just... yes, yeah. Indeed.
Hello and welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hello, friends.
Brian Brushwood.
Ahoy, mateys.
And Mr. Bryce Neshcom Castillo.
So we got land, sea, and air.
Yeah.
We got it all covered.
Yeah. Put your seatbelt on or not. We don't care.
Army, Navy, Space Force, Marines.
So, you know, I don't want to talk about this every week, but it is kind of the science story of the century, which unfortunately is not being treated with a lot of science. No, we're,
ooh, tarantula hawks.
I wish we were talking about that. No, we're talking about COVID and the origins of.
You know what? This just in, my research, I was conducting some research right before we went live. Today, as we record this, September 27th, 2021, is the 1 year and 4 day anniversary of me contracting COVID.
So it was a year ago that you probably had to miss, you had to miss shows because is the week that you were missing shows.
That is correct. This is the 1 year anniversary week of me having full blown COVID in an era before vaccines were known. And when the best Google had to say is, I don't know, you're in your mid 40s. Yeah, 10% chance you're going to die. Anyway, have a great night's sleep. get lots of bed rest.
Hashtag where were the breeders? That's all I'm saying.
What do we give you on a 1 year, like a Perel? What's the gift?
That's right. The first year anniversary is just be socially distant for the day.
Yeah. So, you know, we still
actually some Chinese takeout. That's the 1 year anniversary.
You know, it'll be 2 years ago, December, when the first cases apparently started to break out. And we've been dealing this with, you know, a year and a half, and we still don't know the origins of COVID. There are many theories.
Yep.
And there are many things complicating those theories, particularly, like, I don't know, the fact that the Chinese government shut down, you know, people who were investigating that, all the research databases, anything else could actually help us find out where this came from. But, you know, reasons. Research paper came out about a week ago, which was interesting because they said, hey, we think we may have found the closest genetic relative to COVID, and that is in some bats in Laos. And they said, look, we found some bats in a cave in Laos, and look, it's very close.
Huh.
Like, cool. We want to look at this DNA. And they're like, what about the furin cleavage site? Well, the way the furin cleavage site is this thing in the DNA or the virus that actually makes it easier for it to infect humans. Like, nope, doesn't have it. Like, oh, okay. But still, we don't know. It could be as suspicious as things look.
Question. Where is Laos?
Like down in Southeast Asia.
Okay. So in the neighborhood. Okay. Yeah. I just didn't want to be silly.
Would they be Laotian bats?
Yes, it would be Laotian bats.
Laos is right. Yeah, it's right there.
Well, and let's remember that one of the explanations that were floated by the Chinese government, for which I personally did not take particularly seriously, was the idea that it came in on frozen food. So I don't know whether or not Laotian bats are a frozen food commodity, but maybe.
It gets complicated. So this story came out and people are like, look, you see, we found. And it's like, well, we have it. There's an entire database of bat viruses that was in Wuhan that went missing when the epidemic started. So yes, this is the known closest relative. Also, you know what they did at Wuhan? They brought in bat samples from all over Asia.
The world. Yeah.
Yes. And it still doesn't stop the fact this thing started in Wuhan and they've yet to find any evidence of anything in frozen foods or any of the people, all the markets they tested, nothing, no sources there whatsoever. Then a few days later, a bombshell dropped because the group Drastic was able to find a funding proposal from this group called the Eco Health Alliance, whose name comes up a lot. The leader of this group was one of the people that was part of the WHO investigation to go to Wuhan to investigate, you know, the idea of a lab leak and came back or investigate origins, came back and said lab leak is very low probability, very unlikely. Then it turned out that him and about 20 other people that had signed a paper in a major research journal saying that the lab leak is just a conspiracy theory, all had ties to Wuhan and virus research and were not exactly considered objective. In particular, the Still Events Group had been funding that virus research in Wuhan.
Yeah.
So maybe not the objective bystander you think. Well, this new paper came out, which was a proposal via EcoHealth Alliance to help fund research into basically seeing, particularly modifying the SARS-like virus, what basically we do, your coronaviruses, modifying coronaviruses, giving them to versions of it, like, you know, denatured versions of them to bats or whatever, to try to see if you could immunize them and so on. A lot of scary research that arguably is gain of function research that would be if this was a thriller mystery novel, it would be solved right now. And, but it's not.
Gain of function, just so I have my head straight on this, is where you, something as simple as just let's say you got a whole bunch of ferrets and you got a disease and you just keep on infecting ferrets in a circle. And then at some point by that constant journey, much like we're seeing with the actual COVID virus, sooner or later you get a mutation, and that mutation, whether like in the case of the Delta, it's more contagious, but seems to be not more dangerous. Whereas with Mu, it seems to be more dangerous. That's what gain of function is.
It can be a broad category, and there's debate over what class it is. But basically, the idea is that through some methods, it could be accelerating it through animals, giving it from over. That's kind of a way to do it in lab that makes it look natural. It can be gene insertion. There's a lot of different ways. Gain of function basically means we have a virus, and we help it gain a function.
Yeah, right. I guess what research would do. Would it be a poor metaphor or an okay metaphor to think of it as there's a natural rate of infection that happens in nature, but when you're in a lab and you're doing what normally would be a number of infections that would take months, you're doing it in weeks just because
using one version of it.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Yeah. So somebody points out gain of function is creating viruses to help defeat them. And yeah, absolutely. That's the intent.
Yes.
But the difference between gain of function used to figure out, you know, vulnerabilities in viruses, you know, their potential, et cetera, doesn't look much different between that and trying to make viruses worse, which it's done in illicit weapons programs too. And that is the big, big, big danger. Okay. Somebody says, I'm glad they're doing gain of function research in Wuhan. Can you imagine how bad it would have been if they didn't do that there?
No comment.
Yeah, no comment. Yeah, and it's we don't know. I like, there's a lot of smoking guns, but we need more data. We need more data. And you know, personally, you know, I'm like, well, you know, all the sorts start pointing in one direction consistently, and the behavior of a certain actor there is not doing anything to dispel this. They're not acting in good faith.
This is the frustrating part is. Purely from a game theory perspective, in a prisoner's dilemma kind of thing, no matter what the country is, this is not about the Chinese government or whatever, whatever the country is, it behooves whoever whoopsied to stonewall and block off. That is understandable. It's just a bummer because it's not like we're ever going to get an admission or a confession or an explanation because there's no money in it for them personally, but there is money in it for the world because, you know, we'd be able to solve a lot of things and do better research faster if we had open communication. Every moment we're beating our heads against that stone wall is a moment that we're not doing more research. I don't know.
Scott Gottlieb, the former head of the FDA, who has been a talking head throughout COVID, just released a new book. And part of one of the things that is brought up and he was asked about in doing press for it was, will we ever know? What have you found in your book and your research about the origins of COVID? And he said, what I learned is that we should probably get used to a world where we never know for sure, because the reality is, whether or not it is, unless new data for which we have not been made privy to is given to us, or there is somebody who decides to blow the whistle and quite possibly risk them and their families' entire lives.
Again, to very likely very little personal gain.
I mean, it would be a massive thing. And then it's likely not going to happen. But those things are become increasingly less likely the further we get into this crisis.
I would parse that even more. If it was an accidental lab leak, if it was an actual lab leak, but research that was done in Wuhan, if it was that, and the Chinese government does not want us to know that, then yes, that hypothesis is true.
Yes.
If it is natural origin, and we keep looking and we find a wet market in Laos with pangolins and whatever, and we find presence of this there, independently verified, by the way. I'm not trying to drop hints to any sort of, you know, Chinese, you know, counter operations people are trying to figure out, like, because we were joking about,
we
like the
nailed it.
A prediction we'd made a while ago was that, like, we're gonna see a smoking gun planted in some other country without the ability to sort of defend itself. And I'm not saying that's this here. I assume everything's genuine, but I would say yes, if it was an accidental lab link, the Chinese government is successful in keeping all information out, then yeah, we never know. If it is natural, then there's a very good chance that we could find out. And when I hear people go, oh, we'll probably never know, I'm like, well, which hypothesis does that support? Because we've been able to track down the origins of a lot of other stuff. This one, it keeps going back to, everything keeps going back to, like, you know, that there was a group of people very, like, you know, 2 months in, a month in, this worked, you know, Americans and not just Chinese. And that's the thing too, is people like, oh, it's anti-China. Like, Eco Health Alliance is not a Chinese organization. This is the fingers point back at us too, because a lot of the funding for this kind of research was coming from the US. So no, somebody asks, is it an act of war? No, because the number of people who are culpable, if this is a cover-up, isn't just the Chinese. And there are a number of brave Chinese people who came forward, researchers and people who tried to speak out early on and were shut down, were questioning the origins of this, and the Chinese government censored them, prism, whatever. And so there are very brave people in China that have tried to get some story or some of the origins out here. And there have been people in the West who have facilitated this, have facilitated a cover-up. There definitely is a cover-up. What it is, we don't know. So,
just to wrap your mind around the very good reasons, if you even suspect that you might be the location of ground zero for the release of this, why you might just your default position be to stonewall. Think about the Chernobyl disaster. Let's say in an alternate timeline, a radioactive cloud went and killed, you know, millions of people based on, you know, the winds blew it on over. Then these countries would have a legitimate grievance, and in international courts, they could sue, say, you know, for gross negligence to the United States United Soviet Socialist Republic, USSR. And then all of a sudden, it's like, at the very least, that's an expensive thing to adjudicate, even if it doesn't escalate to an act of war.
And there have been these conversations about reparations from China. Who knows exactly how serious they've been? But these are things that have been discussed. The Chinese Communist Party is not particularly in the business of giving people reason to criticize them. I don't know. I mean, it's one of those things for me that while I never want to close my mind to new evidence, I mean, there's only so many times that I can look at a present under the Christmas tree that very much looks like a hockey stick in wrapping paper and be like, I don't know, could be anything.
I'm certain about many other things with much less evidence.
Yes.
I'll put it that about, you know, so, but we all don't want to be like, and therefore,
no, I mean, you can't close the door on it, but like, yeah. Geez, Louise, it just feels like, number one, the CCP, if they were incentivized to prove a natural link, boy, do I feel like we'd have a natural link by now, because they are very incentivized to do it. We have not seen that.
A pangolin, a show trial of a pangolin.
Yes, exactly. It just,
what do you have to say for yourself? Nothing.
Silence from the criminal. I don't know. It's one of those things that I hope at some point we know a lot more, for sure. In the meantime, I feel like I got enough to have a working theory.
We get this that comes up from time. People go, what does it matter? What matters is this: the history of accidental releases of virus is very scary. It happens way more frequently than we realize. It's happened in US labs, it's happened in labs all around the world. There's good evidence. We know that SARS has actually got released before, you know, that we think that there have been certain outbreaks that have been caused from lab leaks, et cetera. Doesn't mean we shouldn't be doing science.
Yeah.
The fact that there is this there was a conspiracy to shut down information, to shut down critics without evidence should terrify you, because it tells you this is not being done responsibly. This is not being done in a way that you should feel confident in, because even assuming, let's say we found all of a sudden, oh, we found out it was natural origins. Great. This system is so broken with what happened. It was so broken with people immediately circling, or the scientists immediately circling wagons and saying, ah, this is an outrage. How dare people question us? And all these conspiracy theorists and trying to name call anybody questioning them. That's scary. These people should not be involved in science or anything involved with public health, because they're not going to make us healthier. The next thing that could happen could be even worse. And so the idea is, what differences make all the difference?
Yeah, and the metaphor that sticks in my mind is this was a dress rehearsal for something real terrible, and we have performed very poorly in this dress rehearsal.
Yeah. Let me throw this out, because another thing that was brought up in Gottlieb's book was the idea that from an American perspective, that the CDC, for whatever its positives and negatives that you might think about it, is very ill-equipped for the rapid gathering and analyzation of intelligence, and that what his recommendation was from the inside of the federal government at the highest levels, that if we are redesigning how we react to a pandemic, that we should have intelligence agencies be involved in, at the very least, being able to be dispatched to hospitals and hot zones and stuff like that, so they can do what they do best, which is gathering and analyzing intelligence, as opposed to the CDC, which is more of a regulatory agency. That they are not great at the in the moment the decisions that can be made within 24 hours situation. They're not great at that. What do you guys think of that idea? Because it's not like the concept of giving either, you know, any of the three-letter intelligence agencies more control.
Well, especially popular. Since, you know, and again, full disclosure, crazy libertarian here, but it's like a very, very strong case can be made for the fact that it was the CDC and the FDA. I forget which one. They both screwed up colossally. And it was a problem specifically because nobody was allowed to act independent from them. So like one of them was the only one that could authorize a test. And then the other one was the only one that could make the test or whatever. And months were lost in another world. And the example.
Oh, yeah. And then the CDC's test was just garbage. Like it just didn't work. Yeah.
Exactly. In an alternate reality, what I would love to see is like, you know, five FDAs that are all independently, you know, competing with each other. And before anybody, again, this is crazy libertarian talk, before anybody says that's not possible, the example that libertarians always give is Underwriters Laboratories. Anything electronic that you buy has that UL logo on there. You can't buy anything electronic from any Walmart, no Target, no Amazon that doesn't have the Underwriters Laboratory logo on it. That is a completely independent, non-governmental, non-monopoly, but they are so good at testing electronics to see whether or not they catch on fire or whatever, that everybody is trusting them until someone better comes along, which hasn't happened yet. So in that regard, to me, the solution is not to give more power and more authority to a singular governmental entity that just demonstrated incompetence, but instead to create competition.
Well, UL is a great example for many cases. I've actually brought it up when you're looking for like a really successful independent organization. UL ain't going to tell you if your iPhone's going to get jailbroken. It's not going to tell you if there's a zero-day exploit. And as things have become more complex, it's really good about telling you if it's going to burst into fire. And I think the problem with this stuff is it gets way more complicated, and you need to have a tremendous amount of expertise and resources to be able to do that. And UL, these are companies or places developing this have no interest in making consumer products. You know, these are organizations that are getting government funding, and their sole purpose really is to get government funding. In the case of the paper that Drastic found from EcoHealth Alliance, this was a proposal to the military, which would be hard to imagine how an outside. Yeah. But I would argue, I do share your concern of like, great, another government agency. How do we know? But there is something to the idea of in numerous cases. Actually, this was a plot line I mentioned in one of my books where I had somebody who was planning to infect people with a virus who worked for some very murky government alliance sort of organization.
When did you write this, Andrew?
I've done this twice now. I've used this premise twice now. Where the problem
starting
the,
when?
It was the year of the dragon.
One of my Theo Kray books, I go into this and I explain one of the problems is, and this was a problem I explained where what they had when they were trying to look at, like, you know, when these anthrax poisonings showed up. And the number one suspect ended to be one of the leading experts on anthrax. And because there's only so many people that have this expertise. And this was like when the FBI was trying to trace down a mole, they go to their expert on moles, you know, Robert Hansen, and like, we need you to find this guy. He's like, I'll get right on it. He was the mole.
Yeah.
And so there's, when you have very, very small numbers of experts, there's a very high probability that somebody you're asking for help to solve a problem was involved in the, and this is what's been happening in COVID. So I would say when the problem with like CDC and other stuff, it's like, hey, yeah, I'm going to go investigate this. Well, God, my boss actually wrote that grant 8 years ago that did this.
Yeah. Right.
So.
Well, I think that does speak for the importance of disclosures. And as they say, sunlight has a sterilizing effect, and it's hard to hide bad things when more people are two could keep a secret if three of them are dead, or three could keep a secret if two of them are dead.
But then, all right. So in this specific example,
yeah,
like having, like, and let's assume it is a war powers kind of thing, and that
right.
The president has to say, all right, I'm declaring a state of emergency about this thing, and now we can release whatever medically trained operatives from the FBI or the CIA to embed themselves with these situations and be able to report back real time the information. But that means it's now cooperation between three-letter intelligence agencies that have their own problems and the CDC, which certainly is not exactly at an all-time high in terms of confidence these days. Does that make the problem worse or better?
It certainly sounds like a simple fix, and people very much like to hear about a simple fix to things. Truthfully, I don't know that it will change very much. For example, a simple fix is Amber Alerts. That is a very simple fix. A child is missing. Wouldn't it be great? We could think of the children we could save when they're missing by pressing one button and everybody's phone goes off, and then we find the child. If we save one child, I think it's worth it.
Yeah.
But then how quickly do we all tune out Amber Alerts? And now, and how many millions of dollars get spent? How much lost productivities? All of those things. And again, you know, congrats to all of the children who were saved.
Sure.
And the silver alerts and these weird blue
good for
alerts.
You.
Exactly. No, and my condolences to all the kidnappers thwarted.
The blue alerts confuse me because it sounds like a gang war. It sounds like one of ours got taken down. Yeah. Go get them, boys.
Yeah.
Yeah, right?
Wait, blue alerts are gang?
Yeah.
Oh, it's like, but that's not that's
murders,
not for
murders
Crips.
And attacks happen all the times. No, correct. But
oh yeah, but this would just be blue alerts are just when the Crips get killed by the Bloods.
Or anybody else.
Or Latin Kings.
Okay, but
it's 2021.
Here is my point. It does sound like a very simple fix. And I know that people like very simple fixes. I also know that in general, simple fixes tend not to do very much in the long term and cost an awful lot of money.
Yeah.
And lost liberties and.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah. Yeah. Gottlieb's thing was more along the lines of like, they likely would have gotten information faster and would have trusted it more if it came from these sources. Andrew?
I would say that I would say a step would be when you had shortly after this thing emerged and you had 30 plus researchers signing a paper, signing this thing, like trying to shut down the whole blab leak hypothesis, who we now found out through email leaks were coordinating behind the scenes and saying, should I put my name on here? Because I don't want to look orchestrated like we're trying to orchestrate this in the middle of them trying to orchestrate it because of people involved with organizations that were funding this kind of research. And you find out that there were tremendous conflicts of interest in these people signing it when it felt like all these independent researchers around the world are gathered around it, like, no, it's a bunch of people with a lot of, you know, things to lose in this case. I think that from scientific, I think scientific journals in general have behaved very poorly. I think that they have let the public down. They've let science down, like not scientism, but the process of science down. I think there need to be repercussions. I think that failure to disclose your conflicts of interest in this, what are clear conflicts of interest, would a second party go, oh yeah, no, you need to disclose this, failures to do that, and just be like, oh yeah, no, we'll go update, add that to it. After the message got out, after, you know, this was the press releases were sent and reporters based their, you know, their opinions upon this sort of stuff. I think failure to disclose conflicts of interest is a big problem. And it just sort of seems to be like, ma'am, you know.
Well, I think that is
actually I would like to disclose.
What would you like to disclose?
A conflict of interest.
Go ahead.
I have been paid for everything I have said on this program.
What?
What?
I am taking money.
What? Where? Why?
All of our fantastic patrons over at patreon.com/weirdthings.
Oh, go on, you corrupt puppet.
Well, you see, what people do is they give us a buck an episode, and they keep us bringing up the weird news and the very weird opinions. And then we collect the money. In fact, I'm going to disclose, we cashed out the patron. We all, I'm gonna out you guys.
What?
You all received checks.
No.
This very week.
We'd like to thank our new sponsor, Mr. Louse Frozen Seafood.
Exactly.
Delivered anywhere.
Dougie Bats with his brand new frozen Laotian bats.
There are seven faces to Dr. Louse, and they're all smiling after they have these delicious fish. Isn't it the seven faces of Dr. Lau?
Yep.
Okay. All right. I got it right. I got a confused look from Bryce, and I was afraid I realized I was referencing a Roddy McDowall movie from the 1960s.
Patreon.com/weirdthings.
Oh, my mic's
Tony
off.
Randall. Sorry, Ryan, it's Tony Randall.
Oh, doggone it.
Ah.
I know.
Who knows Tony Randall?
Tony Randall!
was he real?
Remember that skit?
No.
That was a Tom Hanks on SNL with the waiter of short-term memory.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's right.
Kept asking Tony Randall for his autograph.
Tom Hanks, Mr. Short-Term Memory.
Yeah.
He shouldn't
Tony
have stood,
Randall.
He shouldn't have stood right under that pear tree. Now his life's a mystery. He'll win you yet, and then he'll forget because he's Mr. Short-Term Memory.
You don't remember the skit? You skit it all, Brian? You don't remember
no,
it all?
No, no, never. No. Tony Randall.
I want to present to you some real estate, gentlemen.
Oh, go ahead.
Well, it turns out that... we're in a bit of a hot market here in Austin. I might have gotten a few texts during lunch.
Yeah, Brian receives anywhere between what? 5 and 10 unsolicited texts a day asking thirstily whether or not he will finally sell his house.
Yes, and they're increasingly weirdly conversational. Like text number one is like, "Hey, I want to buy your house." And then the second one was like, oh, what the, oh, I'm such a stupid idiot. Oh, I'm talking about this one over here.
Yeah, it's the but Chris also Farley really into it.
Real estate company.
Yeah.
It sounds like, it's weird.
All the whores and politicians will scream, sell me your house. And Brian whispers back, no.
I've been working my way through all the James Bond movies and got my way up to Moonraker, which is the Elon Musk biography. And that's the one with the Hugo Drax, the industrialist who's building like space shuttles and stuff. And one of the points there is that he's located in California, but he built like in the middle of the desert, he built this whole like French estate, which is just an easy way for, you know, the Bond producers to do one matte painting and then shoot in France. but I'm like, man, I'd like a chateau. I mean, chateau is even fun to say.
It is. If you say like, oh, come to my house,
No.
Come to House Brushwood.
No.
Come to Chateau Brushwood. Holy.
You know what's even more fun is doing people mad by mispronouncing it. Like, Dan Harmon did with bagels. Like, he had only read the word and never heard it. So instead, it's like, come to my Chateau.
You want to go Chateau?
Chateau
Brushwood?
Let's sit on the Chateau.
But it has like a U, right? So it'd be like, Chateau.
Chateau.
Yeah.
I've got a list of those words that I only read and never pronounced. The people look at you like, oh, you know, you're an idiot. I'm like, listen, am I? Because I seem pretty literate if I know that word.
Exactly. Right? Nothing else, you know, I can read.
Yeah. So, gentlemen, how would y'all like to have a fancy chateau-style house?
Oh, I mean,
love it. Yeah.
Does chateau connote Frenchness, or in my mind, it always connoted cozy smallness. It was another way to say a tiny place.
No, this could be nice. It could be a style, perhaps a style. This house would have nice living rooms and, you know, spiral staircases, and all of that.
I mean, so far, I'm in.
Kind of like one of those towers, a little peak.
Yeah, look at that, man. That looks like a fancy place. I you want to go halvesies?
I mean, you know the three rules of real estate.
Chateau, and Chateau.
Is it haunted?
Not haunted. And
spiders, snakes, and goblins.
I got it. It's in Turkey. It's a very interesting climate. And I got news for you guys.
Woo! Why don't you guys be next?
Why don't you be next door neighbors with identical chateaus?
Okay. Wait,
is it just me or ooh, okay?
This keeps looking
good.
Look
at this, man. It's like a little Disney World.
I know. It looks very Epcot-y. You would definitely have like a very picturesque Instagram content for days.
I could get one too. Bryce could get one.
Hell yeah.
Wow.
This looks the set of What We Do in the Shadows.
Wait, hold on. Wait a minute. And you're telling me out and out that this ain't haunted?
No.
All
and
right.
I'll explain why we know it's not haunted in a moment. But if you like, I'm like, so we're looking at, for our audio listeners, which is most of you, we're looking at these nice sort of mansion style chateaus. And we saw two of them next. And then we saw like a group of like four of them night next to each other, we could all have chateaus. We could be neighboring chateaus, drive around on little golf courts and stuff.
So this would be in Turkey. That'd be a little bit of a culture shock to move to Turkey.
For a split second, I was suspicious this was like a dollhouse set or something.
No,
but now I've seen a picture of like there's actually a nice pool and.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what? I would feel guilty if I lived in a chateau and we lived in a chateau and our friends didn't live in chateaus.
Mm.
What if everybody got a chateau?
Well, I mean, that sounds like a very fair, equal treatment for everyone.
Chaterrific.
Okay.
Here's what that might look like.
Oh my God.
Describe what we're looking at.
I'm waiting for the catch. And the catch is that they're McChateaus.
So, yeah.
It's like 150 of them.
When I first came and looked at houses in Austin, yeah, you realize that there are a lot of places where they have the land and they just build the same house over and 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 over again.
Broke, don't fix it.
Exactly. So imagine that.
Oh my God.
But it's basically like where the Bluths live in Arrested Development, but like a building
Turkish
from
castles.
Epcot. Yeah.
So there was The Onion in their book Our Dumb History represented the beginning of the baby boom with, it says, ant-like conformity available for all. And it had one of those photos of just, you know, all these track plots, everything the same or whatever. Just that for vampires. I'd like to imagine that vampires finally got done with Werewolf War 2.
Oh, my God. There's so many chateaus.
There's so many. It looks like a fake model city. It looks like a model city.
You know what it looks like? It looks like somebody had a paintbrush in Photoshop that just as you drug the mouse,
just
adds
the house. Holy crap. So do we know what one of them goes for? Because I'm not dissuaded. I was expecting it to be full of scorpions or something. Like, if it just means that we got to live in a permanent chateau world.
This is from allthat'sinteresting.com. Castles originally came with a $400,000 to $500,000 price tag, and a handful actually sold.
A handful? Wait, so you get to live in a ghost town of chateaus?
But they had to cancel the sales. The project never opened.
Wait, so they're just there?
Yeah.
No, you're looking for a little distressed property action?
Well, I mean, I it's like a...
I'll tell you what, our buddy Corey Coleman's in Turkey right now. We can hit him up, tell him to make a cash offer on this. Let's go in on it.
I feel like you get shown around. It's like, oh, okay, how much is it? And you're like, only 4 pints a month. Like, pints of what? Don't worry about it. it's a lovely place. You're going to love it.
One of the guys of the property group said, we only need to sell 100 villas to pay off our debt. What? There's more than 100 of these things?
So why does nobody want to live in Chateaupia?
I don't think they reached enough money to complete building Chateaupia.
Good
and
God.
Also, yeah, it's a ghost. It's ruins. It's pre-made ruins.
It's like somebody said, hey, you know those drone videos where they go through Chernobyl and they see the desiccated remains? Let's just skip the nuclear disaster.
This is like,
and just build it.
This is
like drone videos.
Like the fire festival for people with wine cellars.
Like, literally, there aren't roads here yet.
No, it's
there
all,
are
it's
200 chateaus
roads.
And all dirt roads.
But it is like a small town. Mm-hmm. Like we're watching drone footage now, and it's a big ass development. It's in this gorgeous little hillside area in Turkey. It looks fairly lush, so it probably has nice summers and cold winters.
The title of that video said
300 Disney style castles lay empty in 151 million pound Turkish ghost.
Yeah, 151 million pound. So 200 million.
Do we know where it is? Can we see where it is in relation to a city in Turkey that
Dracula?
I might know?
Yeah.
What would be Istanbul, right?
Yeah, that would be the biggest.
So this is in between the Turkish city of Ankara and Istanbul. I'm trying to see if I can pull that up on a map here.
By the way, there was probably some ancient civilization there too, considering the history of.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
I've seen this movie. It ends with him screaming, "You moved the headstones, but you didn't move the bodies."
I mean, but at this point, they're not even trying to hide it.
Like, no, it's like, and they're like, yes, we thought that was fairly transparent.
It's like you're moving into a like bizarre haunted town. Doi, ding dong. Like,
so this is it's a very interesting problem too, because I remember 15 years ago, whatever. You know, looking at the Miami skyline with all those condos that were built, and you know, I have a friend of mine, it said something. It's like, yeah, I don't know what they're gonna do. Like, they're just way building too much. I'm like, oh no, like they do financial projections and all this sort of stuff. I'm sure they know what they're doing. Narrator, they didn't
they
know
did,
what they were
did.
Doing. And then because that was like the 2008, you know, financial crash was, we had all the speculation, prices went up, whatever. It's been in the news late, and again. I'm gonna tie this to China. Not picking on China. We do this thing too. It's a very common thing. So there's no such thing as a local problem anymore. But this brings up, have you seen this? This was in China. They went through this rapid construction because part of the reasons they do a lot of projects and construction in China, it's the way the government makes its revenue is by actually selling land. Like, I used to get asked, I'd been asked to consult on like 3 different amusement park projects in China.
Wow.
And I'm like, what's up with this? And then I looked, I'm like, oh, this is how they make money. This is how, you know, they make money, is they get financiers to spend a bunch of money on building some big project. Real amusement parks take up a lot of land. And so, you know, recently there was this, was it Evergrande Bank or whatever, or Evergrande, which is investment, is having some financial issues. They've shut down Bitcoin in China. And this just happened a couple weeks ago, where they had 15 buildings, which were finance and investment vehicles. And let's see what happens to these 15 buildings.
Oh my God. So, Yeah, I guess they appear to be mostly completed high rises that I guess they figured out there was no need for, so they just went ahead and blew them all up at once because that's more fun.
15 unfinished buildings. They're tall, but you can definitely tell that like the walls are not done.
Man.
And then 15 buildings all fall at the exact same time.
Which inside job.
That's the weird like art to this explosive science where it's just like, okay, how much do you care about that they all go at the same time? And the boss is like, I mean, come on, you're telling me it's going to be somehow better to do them one at a time?
Because also, by the way, of these demolitions
are not controlled implosions at all. Like, their dust is going everywhere.
They are blowing out the bottoms, but not enough to make them not topple over.
Some of these don't. And there's like one in the middle, which I don't know if that was like they just wanted to pull a trick shot and not bring that one down.
There's one designated survivor.
There's one hanging out in the clouds. Oh no!
Wow. No. Yeah. These. It's like. How important is it that we blow all of them up? Very important. Are we gonna get more explosives? Nope.
Question.
Make it work.
I mean, what an opportunity. Does China just pick up the phone to Hollywood and say, "Hey, what do you got in the works? You got anything that needs?" Like, maybe one of the most spectacular background set pieces of all time.
Maybe they call, their own native film industry, which, like, the number one movie of the year is actually Chinese.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Although, what's it called? That's enough to make Christopher Nolan start speaking Mandarin, because that dude loves watching, actual physical things.
Stop!
Also, with that many buildings going down, why not everyone? If anybody who's making a movie can have this amazing set piece.
Christopher Nolan, when he was doing the third of his Batman trilogy, that has the scene of Heinz Field in Pittsburgh exploding from Bane. Originally, what he wanted to do was that they were part of the reason why he went to Pittsburgh to begin with was because they were demolishing the hockey arena to build another one. And so he was in negotiations with the city of Pittsburgh to film it and to have some element of actors kind of in front of it. And it wound up falling through. But that was part of like a big thing. He was like, please, a whole arena. Can I please have it explode right in front of me and have Bane standing in front of it?
There's a man, the DV Rebels guide I read back in 2007, 2008, I think, and it gives so many great fundamentals of framing basic cinematography. It's the first time I ever heard about hosing down a set in order to get, better visuals of sunset golden hour and all that stuff. And there was a section on what he called stolen shots, which I guess I don't know if the whole industry calls it that, but basically you take something that's already happening, and if you are flexible and nimble enough, you just get out there and go. So in this case, he was working on a small movie where they already had this ninja choreographed fight or whatever, and they were planning on, we're getting around, we're going to do it. They had been practicing a whole bunch. And Jay's watching the news, and there's a forest fire that's creeping dangerously close to his town. And he just gets on the phone. He's just like, guys. And then in the book are these amazing photos of just these silhouetted ninjas behind just a wall of flame. Oh, it's unreal.
I didn't think that cool, but I was driving one day, minding my own business, and I look up and I see one of the Goodyear blimps just sort of circling around in like trouble. And then I watched this thing just go and crash.
Oh my God.
I ran home, a slow crash. It was a very slow crash. The pilot's gonna be on board, like, I'm gonna finish this coffee first. All right.
Yeah.
I run home, I get my video camera out of Canon X01, and I race back. And at that point, there was already fire trucks, emergency crews, and there was people handling, the police department were handling the press, and somebody sees on camera, you over there, we're gonna let you in one at a time, we're gonna let you in a group. And I go into the group, and next thing you know, it landed. They managed to take it down in the storage, like a public storage unit area, because there's no people there. And there's this deflated giant carcass of a blimp, And they let us in, and I got my camera because I'm like, maybe this will be good. I'll use this. And so I started getting footage of just what a crash Goodyear blimp looks like.
Jesus.
And that was the funny, again, they weren't hurt. The funny, but like, who gets to see that happen? The funny part was, you know, the comment I heard, like, they're like, how are they going to, you know, how are they going to get rid of this? And it was like, box knives. You know, just literally just send in a crew to just take some scissors and cut the stuff up and cart it away.
While you're at it, why not sell souvenirs? You know, who needs a tarp made from a Goodyear blimp?
So anyhow, that's, you never know. You never know. And that's sometimes you see something and you have to get that instinct. Get my help if you can help, but then get the shot.
But then get the shot. Get the
shot. There was in the movie, I think it was Honor Majesty's Secret Service, was the one where Spy Who Loved Me is the one where Bond does the parachute jump and then the Union Jack unfolds as the parachute. He does it off this big, like, big icy cliff. They talk about when they were shooting that, they were several days in Canada, you know, trying to get this thing, and they had like five cameras, and only one camera was able to get the whole jump for some reason because they couldn't track where that was. It's like, oh, geez, scary.
Brutal.
So, wide angle, folks.
Yep.
Capture it. Oh, there is a Blue Origin launch maybe coming up.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Care to guess there may be a mystery passenger on board?
Oh, it would be, I wouldn't be surprised at all if it was Elon Musk.
I would.
I would be very
surprised.
I would
be extraordinarily surprised if it were Elon Musk.
I mean, whatever. They're all clones of the same billionaire.
That he would make his first trip into space on a Blue Origin rocket? That wouldn't surprise you in the least. In the least.
Well, he's already talked about taking a ride on the Virgin Galactic. So
Elon Musk
has?
Who is not suing?
That's correct. That is a good point.
And Elon got invited to go visit the head. Rogozin, who's the head of the Russian space agency, had invited Elon Musk to go visit Russia. And everybody's like, don't do it. It's a trap. who would you think would make a great, who would make a really good pick for this?
I think I just saw a face flash, but I didn't even recognize him. So I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think it was any of that.
I don't know, though. ICU in the chat points up. Maybe it's Grimes after the split just to get back at
him. No, that would be awesomely petty.
They're still seeing each other when he released the statement. They were in the house. So, you know, who would be? Think Jeff Bezos. Think about Jeff Bezos.
Stephen King. Maybe it would be an author or a novelist.
Who is Jeff Bezos? What do you know that he likes?
Oh my God!
Is it a Star Trek person?
No. Is it from James S. A. Corey?
No. He loves Star Trek.
I was thinking the Expanse.
He loves The Expanse too.
I give up. It's got to be something like that.
I would say, my bet is a cast member of Star Trek: The Next Generation specifically.
Oh really? What?
Should we just start naming people? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Patrick Stewart.
LeVar Burton, Whoopi Goldberg.
Whoopi Goldberg. Wait, is it? Do you think it's Shatner?
No,
that's the rumor.
Oh, Shatner.
Really?
Are you gonna wait, Justin? Let me hear you shut it down.
Because you said Next Generation. All right. Yeah.
I didn't say Next Generation. Star Trek. Okay. I tapped my nose.
So the only thing, I mean, first of all, that's a great rumor.
I thought you meant Star Trek Generations.
Oh yeah.
Oh man, that's actually a really good save.
I mean, look, it would be. It's gonna get a lot of attention. He's gonna do a great video of like I'm going to space at 90. I'm William Shatner.
I mean, that would be the one reason that I would suspect that would shut down the rumor is the liability of, do you want to be the company that I mean, people who are 90 years old tend to be a bit more less hale and hearty than 27-year-olds. And so, I mean, the liability of if something were to go wrong on that trip, handling, like biologically handling the G-forces and all that stuff.
I mean, it's up to him, right? Like, so if he's the one who's saying...
Is that what he's going to say? It's going to be a great...
No, that would be part of the attention. Part of the attention would be... Is and I'm sure Shatner would feed into it because he's a showman and be like,
the
like,
dude did Shark Week last year.
Yeah.
Well, but I mean, I'm just picturing, I'm forgive me. Imagine something terrible happened. And it's like, what is Bezos going to say? Like, what can I tell you guys? He signed the waiver. I mean, the ship did fine.
All right. So
here's something interesting. So back in July, is that this year? In July of this year, aviation pioneer Wally Funk made it to space on Jeff Bezos.
She was on the first one. She was
Shepard.
Yeah.
She was 82.
Ooh.
Now, she's done a lot of flight training, but
she was part of the Mercury 13 she was one of the original women that was selected to prove that women were just capable of going to space as men.
Wow.
But yeah, she was the other, you know, Bezos selected her for that.
Bezos and Bezos' brother, porn actor Bezos. porn, I will definitely say this not about Jeff Bezos, XXX.
I'll say this about Wally Funk. She could probably arm wrestle all of us.
Oh, she's a tough as a $2 steak. Like I watched the rollout video that they did with her, and she is feisty, and she has got more energy at 82 than most women I've met in my entire life.
So, we'll see. We'll see. Like, yeah, I mean, if it's not gonna, like, let's shatter to Shark Week. To Shark Week. I had a Shark Week. Shattered at Shark Week, and I was.
In terms of physical challenges, I would suggest, Your Honor, that perhaps standing in or floating in water, yes, around dangerous beasts, is perhaps less vigorous than.
You hear that, Andrew? Shark Week, super easy.
I'm talking about. I'm talking about on the body of a 90-year-old man. God, don't you do this?
Easy,
don't you do this?
Shark Week isn't even impressive. Why would anybody even think that it's an impressive thing to do? Even a 90-year-old can do it.
I'm not a flight surgeon, but I don't know. Putting a 90-year-old with compressed air 60 feet underwater and the rigors of that for an extended period of time versus, you know, like a 12-minute flight. I don't know what the G-forces are. I don't know the physiology. Yeah. What I'm saying is like it's not the sharks. It's just taking a 90-year-old scuba diving.
Yeah.
And the exertion that goes through there because it's
very easy, according to Brian. Super simple.
Don't do
very
that.
Very simple.
Don't do
easy.
That. That's not what I'm saying.
I mean, who cares, right? Twice on Sunday.
I would imagine, like, I don't remember Blue Origin's the rocket. It doesn't reach escape velocity. It's not going like, it's not like a SpaceX rocket that's going really friggin' fast, you know?
Yeah, that's interesting. I wonder if it's, I hadn't thought about there possibly being significantly
more comfortably. Because it's designed for tourism.
Yeah. It's taking you up. You can take a look.
Take a peek around.
Shatner's going to say some Shatnery stuff, and everyone's going to clap. It's going to be a big viral video. So, wait, Bryce, when is this takeoff?
October 12th.
And this is a rumor, so we don't know for sure. This would be a thing that we might find out either closer to or after it lands, maybe.
Right. They only named two passengers officially, Chris Boschwitzen and Glenn DeVry.
Glenn DeVry?
The Connecticut DeVrys?
So they would say they would experience 3 Gs for 2.5 minutes. I have a feeling that this is the debate that's going on right now. Will this kill William Shatner?
Yeah.
But what a way to go out.
No, Bryce. No.
If I was William Shatner and I died going to space.
What if you're Bryce right now? What if you're Bryce right now?
You don't want to know what Bryce right now would do because he's not doing great. But
Say that twice on Sunday.
Like, you know what? I might dive into the Shark Tank without a suit.
Yeah, well, I thought that was impressive until Brian.
Anybody can do it.
So you ever listen to Bob Einstein, who played was Super Dave Osborne on Riding in Cars with Comedians while Jerry Seinfeld, you know, watches Larry David do Curb Your Enthusiasm? His father was Harry Einstein, Parkiarkas, who was a comedic actor, very, very well beloved guy, who died on stage, right, at like a Friars Club or something like this, you know, died on stage. And people go, ah, you know, well, he died doing what he did. And Einstein is like, no, this is not the way to go. This is a horrible way to go. And he's for his life. People are like, oh, but your dad probably wanted to go that way. Like, no,
no.
Yeah.
Don't die.
When it comes to conditions of how you want to go out, I trust the suggestion of only one person. And that, of course, is Tyrion Lannister.
Yeah. You know, there's a viral clip going around because of Norm MacDonald's passing from his Netflix show. But he was talking with Drew Barrymore, and Drew Barrymore's father, famously, his friends, at his discretion, after he died, used his corpse to startle another friend of his on an acting set.
Oh my God.
So they like came into their trailer and all of a sudden saw the corpse of their friend. And so Drew Barrymore said to Norm MacDonald, like, and I have told my friends that I hope that they do the same thing with my body after I die. Because I thought that it was really funny, to which Norm MacDonald, in his very Norm MacDonald way, and now more poignant than ever, says, you know what I hope my friends do when I die? She says, what? He goes, figure out a way to bring me back to life.
Well, let's go to picks.
Hey, man, I watched Foundation. I had never read any of the Foundation books, so for me it was a fresh experience, and I can't speak to how true to the original it was, but it felt like a very, very big budget, wonderful, electric, powerful production.
I hope one day they make a movie or series based on the book by Isaac Asimov.
What I saw was
It was way so choppy, though. The direction and the editing, it was a little, like, there was a lot. The performances are great. Some of the set design is cool, but, like, I don't know why they held court in a parking garage. It was really weird. But
they really did.
It was a weird. There was
That was the public execution, though. That's why.
No, not that. No, I don't mean that. I meant, like, literally where they had the court proceedings. You know, you're like, this is a very, this literally feels like this is the Montreal Public Library, you know, parking garage or something. But a lot of it, I recommend people checking it out. And I'm not a purist when it comes to adaptations. I am really not. I think that you to make something look in a different medium, you have to change it. Foundation is great. It is very sexist, you know, like, I'm going to bring 30,000, you know, scientists and their wives to, you know, Terminus. There's a lot of stuff in there that's very from that period, et cetera. Changing the genders of the roles, I think, is a wonderful way, because it doesn't take anything away from the story. But man, is it different. And there is a very big theme in the Foundation books that the whole cloning the Emperor himself is not the story, not in the book.
Oh, really?
You know, it's not the way that, no, and it's not.
I thought it was pretty cool.
I have not seen it. I'm excited to see it. The first question that I had, and it's been a few years since I've listened to the Foundation trilogy, but what I remember about that first book is that it's a lot of short stories weaved into this idea to show that, like, this is an expansive thing. And that I remember almost being frustrated in that first book of every time I would get into, you know, the mechanics of one story, they'd be like, anyway, 500 years later, like, here's their great grandchildren, or anyway, here's another thing. And it's Seldon, Seldon, Seldon. It's not until the end of the first book and into the second book that the story kind of slows down and we see kind of some of the cracks and holes of it. But I'm interested.
My issue was sort of like they came up with this device, and it's in the trailer or whatever, the idea that this emperor's cloned himself for a period of time, because it's an empire that's lasts like 10,000 years, but he actually hasn't been cloned. It's a very short period. It's not a spoiler at all. The problem I had with that choice, though, was in the book, and I highly recommend people read in the book. Yeah, trying to adapt that book into a story.
That's hard. It's really hard.
But there are themes there that you go, oh, this is a great theme. And the reality of how the emperor is in the book is a theme that comes up again and again. And they got rid of that. And I'm like, because it's the idea is the power behind the throne, the secret of power, who is really in charge, is a very, that is literally one of the most important themes in Foundation. When you look back and you go, yes, see, this happened here, then it happened here, and they repeated this here, and this caused problems there. And they got rid of that. And I'm like, unless there's some big twist coming, which I don't think, because I just think that Goyer had, who I think is a, can do really cool stuff, was like, oh, let's do this. I'm like, yeah, but it's like Watchmen when you don't get, you know, Ozymandias. It's kind of that thing. You're like, ah, like
there's something missing here. There is a drink that needs a straw to be stirred.
And it's not like, oh, it's like, you got rid of my character. Like no, like there's a theme that just gets set up in the book that you then pick up later on.
Yeah.
And then they just, we'll get rid of that. I'm like, okay. And it's not a lot of talk about the Encyclopedia Galactica either. It's sort of like, you're just sort of like, there's like one table discussion. Like, yeah, what exactly are they doing? What are they doing?
All I'll say about Goyer is that he's got a hell of an IMDb, but if you removed all of the credits wherein he had his name next to other more famous people, boy, does that IMDb not look as
good.
What
do you have against Hellraiser 3 Blood Pact that he wrote and directed? What?
I'm just saying.
Somebody had to use that McDonald's barge for something.
All right. I think, I don't know.
I recommend it, though. I do recommend watching Foundation. I really, really do. I think that there are some really neat visuals. Yeah, I highly recommend people would check it out. Highly recommend people check it out.
Heels. It's on Stars. I think I may have shouted it out before. I'm going to shout it out again. We keep watching it. And I like it. It is a story about a small independent wrestling outfit in rural Georgia. If you enjoyed Friday Night Lights, you will enjoy it. It's very much a story centered around a athletic or niche activity, much in the way the Friday Night Lights is not really about high school football. It's about what happens around high school football and the culture that is there. You know, there are some nitpicky things that I have story-wise. There's some nitpicky things that I have in terms of how they're portraying it as a professional wrestling fan. But there are also moments in it where and just to entice people to kind of get over the wall, because it is a Stars production and that costs money, there is a character of an old wrestler that was a popular back in the heyday of this independent league that went on to their version of the WWF and became the world champion, but hadn't ever really come back and given back to the small foundation, that very much is kind of a Yoda figure, at least to the world of professional wrestling, but is great because he looks like an actual professional wrestler with his half-dyed Fu Manchu beard and, you know, skin-tight outfits that he's like hanging out in this local bar. So like little things like that, I very much enjoy that they take these characters seriously, because they are characters that have their ups and downs and emotions and everything, but they did not skimp on the fact that that's him right there, Wild Bill, who just looks like an absolute lunatic at all times, but is a fairly well-drawn and complicated character, and that is enough for me to recommend Heels.
Cool.
Sounds good.
I got a pick. Yeah, I got a super short pick. Do you guys like time loops? Remember when we were all super into time loops?
Yeah.
Bryce, do you have a pick?
I've got a pick, and they made a video game out of one. This is the new game from Arkane. They made the Dishonored games, called Deathloop. It is a time loop story where you're on this big kind of resort sort of thing where the people on the resort are also taking part in a time loop. It's a little unclear, to be honest, some of the setting stuff, because I'm still early in it. But you're basically on this resort where people are kind of free to do whatever they want because there's a time loop, and you want to end the time loop for some reason, and everybody else doesn't want you to do that. So they're getting you.
Would I be out of line to speculate that they, due to the nature of the story, they would do weird stuff like characters saying things that you don't understand that make sense later and stuff?
There is a lot of like context clues based writing in the script, which I think is really good. Partly because I think in all the promotion for the game, it's like, you have to go and kill these 8 people in one day and that will end the time loop. And you get a lot of setup there. And then in the actual game, it gives you a lot. It really does kind of do a lot of info, like a lot of mechanics dumping, right? Here's the system. You have 4 stages and there are 4 times a day. So it's like 16 and you only get one chance, and you have like they shove all of the story stuff to the side, which is actually kind of refreshing that they're not just like, welcome to Black Reef Isle. This is the time loop island, but you're the like they really don't beat you over the head with it, which is nice. I dig it. I usually don't like shooter games, but I do like roguelike games, and this would be one of them. But it also has a narrative, which I'm told is rather short. So I'm digging it. It's Deathloop. It's on the PS5 and on PC right now.
What's funny is I became more interested when you said a short video game. That's good, you say?
My understanding is that people have knocked it out in about a day or two.
So. Oh, you know what? I became much, much more interested.
Now he's positively tumescent.
So yeah, that's Deathloop. It's interesting because it's also, if you don't keep up with video game news, that is Microsoft making a Sony exclusive title in Deathloop because they bought Bethesda last year.
Oh, wild.
Yeah, there you go. Andrew, do you got a pick?
Yeah, I'm gonna double down on Brian's pick of Foundation. And I know you heard me nitpick the themes of in things that I think are sort of vital, very neat themes of the book, but I do understand the challenge of trying to adapt it. And I do think I'm very curious to see where it goes. The first 2 episodes, there's a lot I really liked, a lot of way it was done. I really like the cast. So please, it ain't Foundation, but it could be pretty good.
Would you say it set a good foundation for another show?
No, Brian. I don't think it did. I don't think it did at all. They missed it.
If we're nitpicking, my review of Why the Last Man is contained in the first letter of the title.
Oh, all right.
Gentlemen, it's been weird. All right.
Boring. It sucks.
All right, Brian, do you want, I'm going to give you a book spoiler. Anybody listening, do you want to hear a spoiler on the issue about the Emperor?
Oh, yeah.
Or Foundation.
Sure. In the book, they go through the court, the royal court, everything is, you know, seems way more majestic than what we've seen here, way more bigger, like Egyptian level scale and everything else. The problem is like we've seen like Coruscant and Star Wars, and it's hard to do like that planet, which Lucas probably borrowed very heavily. He goes and meets the Emperor, presents the Emperor, whatnot, then finds out that ain't the Emperor. That's a puppet. There's an actual guy behind the scenes who's the real Emperor who runs the stuff, and all of that ceremony, everything else is just the thing they've been doing for thousands of years. And that's sort of a symptom that you see that theme kind of come up later on. So that was the sort of thing you're like, I mean, the clothing is not cool, but it's like, but the idea is it's become so bureaucratic. The idea that this thing is collapsing under its bureaucratic weight was a really big point of the book. And here it's like the point that this guy's like, that's I, the Emperor. I'm the real dude that runs things, and I've got to do all these things for show. So.
And cloak and dagger authority is a major...
Things aren't what you think they are.
The coolest, most iconic part of that story.
So
here we go. All right. Well, we're going to do some after things here in just a few minutes. We'll take a short break here. Yeah.
I've got a heart out at one.
Ooh. Yeah. I don't mind promising next week to do a double long after things.
We'll do an extra short weird things.
Yes.
All righty. Then that'll do it here for us with the weird things.
That'll be it for after things. Got any picks?
Foundation.
Thank you, everybody, for hanging out. We'll be back in about 3 hours with Chord Killers.
Really boring. Why the Last Band? It's boring. It's bad. It's a bad show. They did. They massacred a really good book.
We've got Ayaz Akhtar back on the show today, though.
So hey, have you ever seen a cool story where they just where normally in the original they just flash forward like a year and a half and you see a bunch of cool changes? Do you ever think, man, I really want to know what happened every day of that year and a half? Oh boy, is that show for you?
That time jumps in genre stuff, and it drives me particularly back. I mean, at any time, like, you know, we're in a really interesting place. Let's tell you how we got here. No, you had my interest.
Got right. Yeah. I already subscribed. What are you doing?
Well, let me lost. You know, am I really through with it? Lost was like a really bad therapist. Are you really done with your father issues?
Yeah.
I mean, because your healthcare plan will pay for more sessions.
Lost and what was the other Fringe? You know, like, you got to remember those were from an era where it's like, hey man, your job is to get people to show up every week so we can sell dish soap. So say whatever you need to say, do whatever you need to do to cause people to keep showing up every week so we can sell dish.
They just went 2 years too long, because eventually they figured out another thing to do with that convention.
Yeah.
To do like a pocket universe and stuff right. like that. And so it's like they just held on. They didn't take that as license to be like, oh, we can do other things with this moment, especially in a science fiction-y kind of universe where you could pretty much do anything. Instead, they were just like, no, let's find out why Jack doesn't like forks.
And it's,
I'm
it's,
your dad. It, I'm hitting you with a fork right now.
No,
you son of a, oh, you. Spoons and it's, rule.
And it's hard too, because like, God knows. I mean, I look at the J.J. Abrams Mystery Box TED Talk in a totally different way now. By the way,
as a threat,
you. Yeah, but God knows what it's like with TV execs. Like, oh, and this is what you wanted for second season. No, first season worked great. We need more of that.
Yeah.
You know, and more. And they're like, but we want to. No, we got to keep this. This is what people like. I'm like, I don't know, is it? But anyhow,
well, what people won't like is us going off the air, but we got to go do it. We'll be back in a few hours. But
I'll take the fork to you, boy.
Raise your lip.
Everyone, have a good rest of your Monday. We'll see
it's
you in a little
spork.
Oh, the great unifying villain.
Yeah, that was the moment. Yeah, John Locke at the end finds a spork and he starts crying.
Hey, bye, everybody.